Right, good afternoon, but welcome to Allotment committee meeting. At this time, we welcome two representatives from Allotments. And as we all know, we get a 15-minute, we've got representatives here, 15-minute forum where they can ask questions. Now, after the 15 minutes, we close down. So, welcome to you both. 15 minutes. Have you got any report?
Yes, one that came last night over the phone. Apparently, they believe, because we have no pressure on our water tap on the people that haven't had for some time, apparently they think it's from the fountain from the cemetery. I've tried to explain it. Well, it uses its own water, but that person literally called me out and then came round again this morning. But I can actually vouch. Yesterday I was over the allotment, and there is hardly any water coming out that tap. Yeah. And there's got to be a reason for it. It's 3 years now, in the summer months, this has happened, and we need to have that water sorted out.
Yeah, we've contacted the water board today, and they're going to come out and have a look at the pressure in the next 24 hours, so we can sort of go from there. But the connection to the fountain, as I say, it's just a trickle feed, and I removed it and still done like a pressure test, and it didn't seem to make as much difference. So until we have the professionals on board and come and have a look, we're not really going to know. So yeah, so that's in the next 24 hours, we'll have a better picture of what's going on.
Okay. Because the thing is, also, do you think there's a leak underground?
Yeah,
I did think that.
There could be that it's old iron pipe in the feed, could be that corroded up, whatever. But we don't want to go around sort of digging up everywhere, so we're going to sort of investigate. I'll do the obvious stuff first, and then proceed by that.
Can I ask what site that is, please?
Dig me away.
Thanks very much.
The feed is from the cemetery.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Well, just one thing. First of all, the allotment competition runs by Thetford Garden Club, but on behalf of the council, I'd like to thank you, first of all, for funding it for this year. Having done the judging this year, we realise that probably we'll have to change the format for future ones. You've got an increasing number of half plots, and now in fact even quarter plots coming in, which means this rules and regulations that we've laid down for many years will have to be changed. Still got ideas about it. I'd like to see more involvement with the associations, that's Berry Road and Mumford Road, and probably the council as well, in the planning and the judging of it, rather than keeping it just to the Thetford Garden Club. So some ideas, we've got to discuss it with Yvonne and my committee members, to come up with some sort of plan, put it to the other association and the council to say, we think this should be the way forward. The other one thing that was very pleasing to see, and I found, and I thank Karen Robinson for her support in sorting out the details of the competition. But what was very pleasing to see was, in fact, from 2019, when we last held the competition, we've had 72 new committee presidents, allotmenteers. Went through us a bit, because we normally get about two or three novices. On the judging, we ended up with 20 novices on it. So that's pleasing to see on that side.
Now,
we've got to rethink it all. We've got some ideas. We've got to sort them out between the teach actors first, and then present them to the committee, the council, and the volunteers and the associations, all involved, to see whether they accept the new ideas. But please continue to fund. Thank you.
No, I just think it's all good news.
And I think the only thing is with the funding, obviously it has to be applied for every year, because it's like when myself and Alan were talking, we can't, the idea of moving they're so out of date.
It would help if we had an updated map now and a regular one as you change. Because it says you've got half plots, quarter plots now coming.
Yes. Yeah, Jack, I just wanted to say, sounds like an awful lot of work being put in by Brian and his and doing the building and everybody. And thank you, you know, it's all well hard to do, you know. Without you, we'd be no trouble sometimes, you know, especially with this. That's our premier event, really, isn't it?
Well, I would like to thank you as well. As for maps, I mean, I can give you the ones that I've got. Roger made these,
okay.
These maps, and they, but because the Monfort Road and that's all changed from this, but I mean, I can give you, or you can take copies of these, and then if you could, say, get someone to escalate on that and to then put the numbers where they are, that would help us an awful lot with the competition.
Yeah, because the other sides are pretty easy, so the numbers follow suit. You go on the road or everywhere.
Well, the other way you don't need to change, because I can put half plots in there, because it's just straightforward, isn't it? Manford Road, obviously. London Road is another one. There are lots of half plots on long ways rather than short ways. And Bury Road as well. And that's my map for Bury Road. Half of it I've already got A or B on this.
We try and incorporate boundary pathways as well, that should make it a little bit clearer as well where the plot starts and finishes.
It still helps if there's a map to go by.
No problem.
Okay, thank you.
Can we look into that then?
Yeah.
An updated, as you say, it's more London Road and
Manford
Road. Thetford
Road
is available.
Bury Road. And London Road, because Magdalen Street is quite straightforward, isn't it?
Chair,
yes.
We had a project of when we had enough staff to do it. We did have a project of renumbering all the plots and everything, and making more sense of it because it's a jumble right now. But I take it that because of our shortage of workforce, that project is not going ahead either. Because it's
a big job. Talk.
Yeah, well, that's when we did. When I was chair, we said we should do it and everything.
Yeah.
And it never came off because I think we don't have enough staff.
Yeah.
Can I just answer that? When we went round in July, I think the majority of the plots are numbered.
Now,
one or two are sort of a bit difficult to work out. But I think most of them actually now. We were a bit thrown by 88 BQ.
Is there, I mean, Mumford Road being such a big site, is it? I don't suppose it would be possible to start from just count out the British Rail site and just everything being Mumford Road, because we would prefer if we take out the British Rail and just go from one to however many plots were on there, four plots, and then.
If it could renumber it and do it all as Manford Road,
it's actually judged just as Manford Road, it's not done with British Rail at all now.
Yes, do it all.
And would that be something that maybe the committee, if they wanted to get involved in, is go around and do that at the same time, etc.?
Yeah, I mean, see, the majority are on numbers and they're on piece of plastic with the OE clock. They are renumbered. So it's just start from one end and work it through. It might not happen straight away, we could make a start on it.
Would that be better for us?
I think if you've got to really think about it, so if you're going to start with renumbering, you do your renumbering and that goes onto a spreadsheet. And automatically, if a whole plot has all of a sudden gone to four quarter plots, then you have to just go to that plot and mark them as the four quarter plot. So you'd have to then have ABCQs, wouldn't you? So say I was going to number 3 plot, and the people have gone, so I've now changed that, and 4 people have gone, and they've got 4 plot page. So you'd have number 4, 4A, 4B, or you'd have 4AQ, 4BQ, like that, so that if anyone is coming around, actually, Mr. James has got 4CQ, and then you know exactly. I don't think it's just a matter of just going up there and changing numbers, because you've got to look up when you come back.
The problem would probably be not so much my side of things, but the other side of things.
That's what I'm saying, it's all got to mingle in together.
The database, all that's got to be
that's got to coincide.
That's where the work comes in.
That's what I'm saying, yeah. So it's got to go hand in hand.
Are all plots now accessible, because at one time we couldn't get through to some of the blocks.
Yeah, mostly there,
there's lots of gates and stuff.
Yeah, I'm thinking on the plots that the representatives have asked on that matter. I'm thinking that if we do get them lined out again,
right,
and that properly, obviously, then we'll have to give a copy of what we've got over to Brian for.
Send it straight through, and it updates it in your office anyway.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure that's how Carl would, I'm sure that's how Carl would do it, but I wouldn't because I'm not that technically minded.
Somebody has to go and physically change out on the spreadsheet to a different number.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you can go there, you just send it through.
Yeah.
Twice.
I'm sure between them they're sort of
if the plan is to change over in February, perhaps at the end of this year, like December, Matt's pre-prepared. So at February, you're well aware of what plot's going to be numbered what, and it's just a day of people going with a map and putting new numbers on, and then saying, get the letters prepared in advance,
yeah.
Ready to go out, and then it's good to go in February.
Yeah.
Are we agreeing on this?
Yeah,
so we'll put it down as an action point for now, September.
No, thank you.
February.
January for the room.
Yeah, something needs to do it before to get
it. Well, you need to do it before Carl gets overloaded with work in the
Chief, I could just add one point. At the last meeting, we mentioned that Carl had to kind of go, you know, step back for one day a week.
Yeah.
But we have managed to get someone to assist him. So I'm hoping that there's a net gain of working days allocated to allotments on average rather than a reduction. So Carl does have someone to help him for this. For three previously it was 2 days,
yeah.
For 3 to 4 days.
So they don't tell you.
No.
So there was two bad.
Well, I think what it is we are not responsible because they lease that land. But what we could end up with is if they're burning their own land and their sheds, it could impact on another shed. What you know, we've got nothing in our regulations. We was going to look at when people should burn and when they shouldn't burn. I know you was the different case, but we was going to look at, because this is during the daytime that they was burned out. On Sunday, I think it was, it was April.
Well, what was June 4th?
Yeah. That's been two times, you know. I mean, they probably recharge the people who's called them out, but I think it's something that we need to be aware of.
Well, we're trying to educate people not to have so much rubbish restricted on structures and things like that, to try and eliminate the cause of having fires. But then it's all stems on the strength of the inspections. If we can keep up to date with those, that's the key to do it.
I think we need to look at our allotment policy about fires, and I mean, like, if I'm going to burn, I've got a dustbin, so I'll burn it in there. There was a lady on the station road, so she used to burn her rubbish in there. So she's not going to cause a big fire across the allotments.
It should only be the stuff on the allotments anyway, but sadly a lot of people do bring in their own outside rubbish. But, I mean, how can you keep enforcing if you can only burn your allotment rubbish? You just say, I mean, if they turn around and decide they're going to put an extra shed up or that, and they want to get rid of an old one, what do we do? What can we do? But say, if you're limiting times of fires and that, then Carl can only do his during the day. If you turn around and say to allotment holders, you can't do your job after 6, because I think they're used to it all years and years ago, that used to be after 6, obviously. Yeah. Carl's position, he can't. So is it going to be a backlash? We know how some people are. Well, he's burning his rubbish at 2 o'clock, Carl wants to burn mine at 2 o'clock. Mm. You know, that's where it's got to be sorted out.
Yeah, he used to not be able to do fires on Mondays because we used to put out the washing on Mondays.
And when I lived in Germany, it was Sunday, you couldn't do anything on a Sunday.
So,
you know?
I mean, but I'm a big supporter of allotment holders having allowed the people to have fires and everything. Otherwise, you end up with masses of debris you can't utilise. So it needs to be looked at.
It should only be
stuff on the
allotment. Yes.
Well, that's the rules now, isn't it?
Yeah, that's in the rules.
It's the rules now.
Any more on that one? Right, item 294, health and safety. You arrange your removal of asbestos sheeting from a shed on box. So that is down to Chris Hancock.
Yes, that was the block where they're interested in having the keeping area very broken. Recently, gentlemen relinquished. It's found a small shed's got asbestos sheeting for the roof, so I've just got to get a quote for that to be removed, and that will be dealt with.
Knowing how strapped we are as a committee for funds, have we got enough money in it? I know we have to do it because it's that, but it's an expensive thing, isn't it, to have it removed, and so have we got enough funding to do such a thing? Because the last time I read the funding, I must admit it's a few months back, we had virtually no extra money. We have the smallest budget of any committee on the council at the moment, and again, where is it coming from?
I think this is one of the things that, sorry, manager, this is one of the things you have to do anyway. So the council, if the committee could not afford it, the council would have to pay anyway.
Yeah, but then we
under
have
the health and safety. Well, yeah, but I mean, I don't know how much it is to remove asbestos, as it's in the open air. It might not it might not cost as much as what it would do if you was trying to take it out of this building.
But you're looking at
The ultimate block, the tenant had it for over 20 years. I mean, it's not a recent tenant, so we shouldn't get much more of this. It's only if something very early we come across it. So it's not an isolated case, really. I don't think we should get any more of this. I mean, I've done inspections on all the plots, and this is a shed which was it's covered with nearby holly bush, so it wasn't obvious. But I say this chap's had it for over 20 years, so we can't really, you know, he may have already been there when he took it on. But the, you know, when we've started these stringent inspections, new tenants, we shouldn't come across any new asbestos. If we do, then it's
down to that
tenant.
Maybe that's something we need to put in, that if asbestos is found on your site, you will have to pay. Maybe that's something we need to put into your rule book as well.
Disguise it by burying it, which we've come across.
Yeah, in the good old days, I can remember walking the allotments and the sheets of asbestos up against the fence all over the place. That's gone now because the work of our offices is done, but you're still going to find few bits and pieces.
After the regulations, people won't be able to get hold of asbestos to make sure.
Right.
So, it won't be an issue in the future unless they've got some dodgy stash somewhere else.
Yeah, you should be surprised when you do the allotment inspections. You'll be surprised what you find on there. Chris, have you got anything?
No, I don't have a lot. I went round. I haven't been in the other way. I'll be looking at that reason. So, Ferry Road, no issues. Ferry Road's really good. No issues at all. It's coming on nicely. More than happy with that. London Road, same old issue. Gateshead does it. There was two fires going at the same time, different plot holders. So along with the inverted pallets, bits of wood and bits of pieces. Apart from that, wasn't particularly dressing. Mumford Road, I was really impressed. I hadn't been to Mumford Road for a while because of the other things. I was really impressed at how good it looks. It's allotment 88 on the end, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. Really better than my back door. But I did find this. Yeah, plot 71. I don't know if you can all totally pass it round, but there's spikes.
Oh, it's spikes.
Yeah, and I'm not having to tell them my spikes.
Is that my
God? This Harris Benson, he's cut the panel out to meet the height regulation. Mm-hmm. He's left the top.
Top says spikes, yes. No.
I'm looking for the spikes. It's taken us a long while to get barbed wire off and razor wire and pieces. I would like just to find a way to meet
I can have a word. I know it's a plot that is. I'll even offer to reduce it for us. So you can take that off. I've got a grinder, I'll do that. It's quite elderly.
Access. I went to Mumford Road on its short time, so first of all, I lived there for ages, walked the way around, and the blackberries are really nice. So, it was really good. That's the only issue I found.
Yeah, thank you for that, Chris. I'll say the spikes
are neat. Yeah. I've got another question, sorry. Nothing else to know. I've come to you, I meant to ask you. The brackets put on the gates on the Berry Road.
It's not the jobs to do, Chris.
So we are now on 295, allocation and waiting lists.
Okay, so there's a total of 49 residence applicants. 38 of these have have priority over existing tenants in the way that we're going to offer people who haven't got an allotment first. We've got 11 existing tenants who have expressed interest in taking a firm plot, subject to their existing plot meeting the required standards. We've got 20 waiting applicants that have been contacted since our last meeting, resulting in, out of the 20, only 9 applicants taking up the offer. We have 13 vacant plots, 8 vacant plots are under offer, so that's 21 in total.
Any comments?
No, we're getting there.
We're getting there. I will say though that where we've got tenants with existing plots, I would prefer to see new tenants coming in over there, but that's just not my
We can then do tenants priority over.
Yeah, that's what I think, because I think sometimes you can get somebody that's got maybe, I think it was a case a couple of 3 weeks ago, in Montford Road or something, near 4 or not. Yeah, thank you, Ten. Thank you for reminding me. I knew it was 3 or something, but he had 4 plots and he ended up having to take him 2 back because of the conditions and that, Brenda.
When you say plot, do you mean a whole plot? Because, looking at it, you took a quarter plot and you've worked that for 2 years, and actually the quarter plot next year is empty. And you think, do you know what, I can cope with the quarter next to me, but you wouldn't want to do another quarter because somebody has come along and you've allocated that to a new existing one, so you've offered them the quarter plot up the other end. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah, we haven't got many quarter plots. So these are mainly half plots.
Okay, that's fair enough.
But no, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
Anything else on that one? Okay. Item 296, meeting the Brown Yes, please. So, Alan, lead on this one.
I thank you, Jim. What we did is we identified abandoned allotments as one of those allotments that had actually done quite a bit in terms of becoming independent of the town council, just to see how it worked and to get an idea of what we could do from our side to possibly increase the funding that's available to allotments. As a town council, we stuck allotments competes with all the other activities that we do. And sometimes it comes off as the second cousin because, it's got a very small budget. The budget's only £8,000. We've got other departments and functions that have budgets of hundreds of thousands of pounds. So it is very easy to neglect that. So what we've been trying to do in the last few months is just get an idea of how allotments run, what are the different options available to us, and we could explore that. So we identified Brandon as one. We had a meeting on the 21st of July. It was very interesting because Brandon Allotments looks as if they, and I have to be careful how I say it, that they did a coup on the Brandon Town Council and managed to secure the most independent, kind of declared independence from Brandon. They have no, the Town Council has no involvement whatsoever in the Brandon Allotments. So they run it, they have their own kind of structure, their own governance structure, they collect the money, they decide how it's going to be spent, and they do everything involved in it. But what was very interesting was that they've only been around for about 3 years, and they had already secured about £13,000 in funding. So they had done a lot of improvements, they improved the fencing, etc. They had a toilet sponsored by the lottery fund, and they just found it a lot easier to do that as an independent organisation, whereas when they were part of the council, they couldn't actually do that. And then what they did is they, from our perspective, we just took notes, we listened very carefully, took notes, but it did provide some insight to us of just, there is an alternative way of looking at running allotments. It's not necessarily what we want to do or what our allotments want to do, but it just opened our mind up to see the kind of rounds of possibilities that were available for us. So we made no commitments, and I don't think we have made any commitments. We've made no policy decisions. It really was a fact-finding mission. Councillor Tullett Councillor Cannon, Councillor Harvey and yourself, Chair, were, and Carl were allotment officer, we all went along and did that, like I said, to do it. I think it summarises our visit.
I've got 10 words.
How did they get around their commitment to and statutory regulations that they have to have allotments, town council owned allotments? Or did they use the regular Brandon thing and kind of ignore it?
They actually went in and got all legal, all my understanding is from talking with them is that they were actually went, got legal papers drawn up and took them to the Brandon Council and offered these documents to the town council, Brandon Town Council, and they signed them.
Yeah, but did they have authorisation to sign them? Because under the Allotment Act 1952, the council has a responsibility to supply allotments to the residents.
Yes, well, that's Brandon for a start. Mm-hmm. This was just a fact-finding mission to see how they
yeah, done it. Yeah, I mean,
it's a great thing. And I think it was, from what my understanding in the talk we had with the gentleman it looks after it, is that, yes, they, because they weren't getting the support and that from the council, that they did get legal documents set up and took them to the council meeting, and then they were signed, and that's how that council deal with their allotments, providing their allotments for residents, that is completely up to that council. That's not... So it's not going to happen here like that. It could never happen here like that. It was just a fact-finding tour. And so how they deal with providing allotments for their residents is completely out of our influence.
It's always good to learn different ways.
I don't know, maybe join Brandon Council online, because they... and ask, but yeah.
It'd be interesting for somebody to find out how we got around the statutory law.
I mean, that's a different rules.
Yeah, can I just come in there? You have to understand that although by law, councils should provide...
Have to.
Should provide allotments. Now, it's not every single village and council has to do this, so Brandon might have been small at the time, but what the council done is they leased land from the sports centre. Right? The land belongs to the sports centre. So in essence, what they were doing, council was charging the allotments and then paying to lease that land. That's how they provided their allotments. So the Brandon Allotment Committee cut out the council and they are leasing directly now from the Wasit. So they're running their own allotments. Beautifully laid out, weren't it, Carl? Mm. It was very well managed. You know, he said they do get the odd sods where he says, you know, they want to do the water back because down there they're lucky enough that they allowed to draw so many litres out of the river. So they fill up their containers. Mm. So the whole, you know, it's just the way they're doing it. We couldn't do that because we can't go around giving land away. You know, we wouldn't say, oh okay, Berry Road, you can take all that land, that's yours, we don't want nothing for it.
No.
We couldn't do that. But there is a structure that you could say, actually, on the day-to-day issue, we can work in partnership here, and all we need you to do is pay the bills, for example. You pay the water bill, but everything else you take care of yourself. Now, that is the that could be just the centre of the allotment. So the actual allotment of what you're working, we might still have to take responsibility for the surrounding, that outer surrounding of the allotment. So say that came back, things like that. There's different ways of doing things.
There is, and at the moment it's
it's a work in progress.
We're not discussing that this can happen because the land is the council's. And as you say, we can't turn around and say to, we can't give our land away, but there is ways around. But this is actually about the allotments on the ground.
Thank you. What we asked the Allotment Association for documentation, and the only one, you know, I wrote to them afterwards and prompted them, the only one document that they ever sent to us is their rules. They did promise to send us their perspectives, but unfortunately I haven't seen it, and I, you know, they were very kind to us. I stopped badgering him in case we need to talk to them again.
Do you think that's something I can speak? Because I've got.
Yeah, that would be very great. But they haven't sent that document. They did send the rules and other information, but not the prospectus.
Right, I'll give him a ring.
He said he couldn't find it when he tried to speak to him.
Yeah.
Raising funds and getting grants, that's the biggest bonus that I thought came out of it.
I was amazed at how much they can actually raise being tied to the council.
In the toilet was a project on hard, I think, when they
got the toilets. You see, councils can't do that, they weren't funded to do a lot of them.
Yeah, whereas they get being able to get their own funding, as I say, I mean, like this just said, they've got a disabled, they've got toilets there, and it got money raised by.
Yeah, really nice. But on that, we looked into having a toilet put into Montford Road before and everything. And we have had private funding for the allotments in the past, haven't we? Some funding.
Not
from
as
charities. Not as much as them.
Not
obviously.
As much. I mean, in their bank at the time was sort of 30,000. And I know when I was talking to Jack before when I was trying to set up a meeting. It's over 14,000. I mean, they could go for the Tesco bags, they could go for this and that. It's surprising. Whereas,
how big is their plot? How many plots do they have?
I can't remember.
They're not as big as.
It's not.
They're not as
big
as.
It's not as big as single roads.
And their budget right now is twice what we got. Just about. We bought
They are doing really well. Mm-hmm. Very well.
It's in between Berry Road and England Road, if you imagine, between the two of them.
We only got a budget of about 8,000 a year, haven't we?
Well, I'm going to say they've gone and got 13,000 in a grant. I mean, we won't be able to get that. We couldn't all get it for one side because we've got so many sites, we'd have to share it between, in fairness, all sites. For an individual allotment site, as they've done, it's really good. I mean, say we couldn't turn around and say to each allotment site we've got, here's 13,000 and buy yourself one of these green toilet things.
It's lovely too, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's different sites per annum.
No, it's a compulsory, a common, joint effort all the time. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a really good thing to do. So you can see it's the next item on the agenda. It's like what we're looking at, the very road book. It was a way forward. I mean, we have to take all steps to get as much information as we can to make sure that we make the right decision. Not only for your local holders, for the town council, the people who make the money. You know, so you need to go from a bold position. But to go and see what they did.
Yes. way forward, but obviously we've got to cut off the end of the bank line.
It was a way of looking at the day day-to-day running of her allotment is done by everybody that works that allotment. So the water baths are getting empty. Right, actually I need water. So while I'm doing that, I will, you know, take the pipe down to the river, put it in and fill up that back. It's about thinking of not just you, you're thinking of the whole allotment scheme. So it does need an allotment area to all think about, not if this is not just me, it's you all working together and to achieve it.
I thought that's the whole idea between us organising each allotment to have their own association, so that they can coordinate their actions and help with the management of the plots and everything.
Yeah.
You know me, I'm very much against giving all power to the allotment association, though I'd love to support them in a lot of things, and they have offered us a lot of help in the past, which we haven't taken up because of health and safety. You know, so I'm for the associations having, you know, day-to-day help with running it and everything, but I'm very anti us giving all the power to them and us city, because we wouldn't need a committee anymore.
The thing is that at the end of the day is that we cannot hand over a load of power. I mean, I hate the word control of power.
It's working in balance.
We cannot hand it over because we own the land. You just said yourself then that in past, I mean, well, I've been here since 2015, haven't you not? And I think in past, we've had a lot of offers of help from allotment holders to keep the areas tidy, to do this, to do that. And as you say, often say it was always brought up and put into the pot. I mean, if they're able, I've got an allotment and I'm streaming my allotment down and weeding it and whatever. What is the harm if I've got an extra 10 minutes to go out and to keep the paths clear around my allotment? There's no harm in that. So I don't need a health and safety certificate to get my schnooner out and do a bit of grass that's over my fence, because...
That's not the conversation. I'm supporting you.
If you're capable of getting the use of your schnooner, why do you need a health and safety certificate to do the grass? You don't... Common sense. And it's not giving control or whatever, it's working together for the best. Better for the council and the
government. I'll always work together with people.
But I say, this is just something that I find at all on how things could move, obviously not that far, but how we could move forward for our budgets.
We have been doing this for over a year now.
Yeah.
Working with them, we used to have informal meetings before this pandemic
came
up and everything. So we were trying to walk through this process, and I was there at most of the meetings and everything. And I would be, you know, if there's ways, we need tap finding like we did. You know me, I'm
scared. I know, Dennis. And you know, for day one, I can say to myself, my problem's going to be Dennis.
Yes.
But it's
sensible,
you know, it's sensible, you know.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get a balance.
Yes.
I did ask the brand of lockdowns regarding health and safety issues, and they have all their courses and retrained, the ones who are doing the thing. So, I mean,
when we went to Switch, there were certain sites on there that were health and safety challenged. Yeah.
He must have goes through medication or piece of stone, it's another lot and older than every one.
Common sense.
Common sense.
Like,
of course, if you breathe and there's dust in the air, you're
walking.
Have
you any more on that, Alan? So, should we move on?
This is just for noting.
It's just for noting. Thank you very much. Right, item 297 is a meeting with the Road Association. Would you like to come up?
Sure. What we did is we wanted to get an idea of what our allotment associations, what their temperature was in terms of this. So the chair, myself and Carl met with the Bury Road Association on the 12th of August at their actual allotment site. And we had a discussion with them. I think they were very surprised with how we had approached it. We basically said to them, there's the status quo, and there is the Brandon model, to call it that. And where do we need to position ourselves? Because we have to come back to this committee to have an idea of what are some of the possible operating models that we could discuss, and how do we ensure that if we can empower the allotment associations a little bit more, could they be in a position to actually run the allotments better than we are, trying to spread our limited resources over 6 allotment sites? So we had a discussion with them. I think, to be in my honest feedback, and I had this with the chair, is I think they were very surprised at what we put on the table. I think they were actually taken aback, because I thought they were just going to ask us to do a lot more work and have no responsibility from a management perspective. So I think they were surprised. The feedback we got was that they were supportive of investigating a model where they might be a little bit more empowered, and they've confirmed that to me in writing. I got an email late last week from the chair of that allotment association to say yes, they agree in principle, but they won't. You know, they're not committing to do it tomorrow. They would just like to explore it, and they're happy to do that. And I think that was really the issue that we're coming to the committee today. Do we have a mandate to actually look at alternative models, to bring it back to the committee to formalise, or do we, and as we've covered this discussion, I know at the previous point, or do we, you know, it really is to say, do we need to look at alternative models? Do we just say, well, status quo is working for us, we continue, or do we need to look at and see how we can possibly get the allotment committees to help run the allotments, get the benefit of that going forward, and having a little bit more financial flexibility deciding what they're doing, and we have a reduced responsibility, but we still always have oversight. And I think that was the key thing we said. This is not we walking away from our responsibilities. We would put in place a governance structure and an oversight structure so that we could actually safeguard the council's interest and ensure that at the end of the day, it's not just for the allotment associations, it's actually for anyone who runs an allotment. It's got to work for them as much as it works for the council. So that really summarises that. I think, Chair, Carl, if you've got something to add, I think that summarises our discussions.
I was quite taken back, because the questions they asked, and as we were giving them the right answer, giving them the answers, they were quite taken back. But say, this is only an investigation here, and that, so they're not no dentists.
As usual. Would this entail us giving them finance to do these extra things and everything? So would we be turning over public money to organisations who are not made in the way of grants? Because we could do it with grants, couldn't we, legally? Or my basic question is, would we still control the purse string to it, or would we be putting it out to the groups to do some of the work and money? Because then we'd have troubles with dividing out the money to all our allotments. If we do it on how many plots we had and everything. So, you know, it could become complicated.
It could be. This would be, if the committee agrees, would only be a test. It's a test pilot, basically.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be open to all allotment sites at this time, because if the feedback from a site, it doesn't work, then we're obligated, obviously, that we take back. It'll be a gradual process with what is what. They will still have to follow the committee's rules. And so it'll be done in stages. You can't turn around and say to somebody, right, there's £3,000, that's your share of your allotments. It's come from allotment money. The money that the allotment committee spent comes from the allotment pot, and that's about, I mean,
So we're not turning around, and I'm not saying to them, I don't have an allotment, so I'm not being asked to pay to give us any site money. So it's within the allotment committee's remit, and it comes from each site. So have you got this review out in the comments?
So,
everything would have to be done in a breakdown so that you can't turn around and say we can't turn around and say to by any of them that we're going to give you X amount of money because we can't do it. It's got to be a gradual introduction and that, and to see how it works. But also, if at the end of the scheme, the trial run, if you like, it doesn't work, obviously the council just brings it back into house. Alan, would you like to take over?
I think really what we're looking for is the fundamental question is, do we explore this further? And based on our meeting at Berry Road, we can come up with an operating model. We didn't say, hey, wow, this is how it works. And they themselves didn't want to do that. They actually said, well, look, we'll do it in a phased process. So what I think we're looking for is that there is a keenness from Berry Road to actually do this. Can we explore it? We'd always come back to this committee to get the kit. And we put in place the governance, we put in place, but they will, they've said to us, the first words they said to us is, what's your time frame? You're going to be looking over a very long period of time. So how it might start is, they might have a little bit more say in the budget that we allocate to them, what's more important, because they might say, at the moment, we're spending a lot of time trimming, doing that. They might say, well, if you do that, we do that, can you do something else? The whole process of how we use it and how we engage with them might actually change. So it really is a mandate, and this is really what this item on the agenda is for. We know that Berry Road are quite happy to be part of the experiment. Can we proceed, when I say we, as will the committee approve, the next step of actually exploring it a little bit more detail, coming back, so at the end of the day the committee signs off what is actually agreed. And we can ensure that all the checks and balances that we need from the council side are there, and the Berry Road Association can check from their side that all the checks and balances to protect them as an association and to protect their allotment holders are also in place.
Going forward, personally, we've got nothing to lose because it either works or it don't work. And you always start off with a small scheme, see if that actually works, and then you can progress through the way to the aim in what your total aim is, them to have their overall control on a day-to-day basis, and then the council are in the background. And, within the rules you'd say, well, a council will attend all your committee meetings. There's different ways where the council keeps informed, and then councillor reports back, oh, I do the Berry Road one, this is the report from Berry Road, if it's spread out across Thetford, this is the report from the Mumford Road on the Mumford Road rep. And it's just looking at how you're empowering people to get things done for themselves. Because, you go up the allotments and say, oh, why can't the council do this? Why can't? Well, because we haven't got the money. But actually, as a committee, you could do. And you've got to let people move forward. Of course, it could be that in 10 years' time, what you've set up to say, for instance, we had one going right now in 10 years' time, that might actually collapse because the nature of the people that have got the allotment. So it'll always go by the nature of that committee. If it's a strong committee and all the allotment holders are working towards that aim, it works. And then over time things change and then it stops working. Because if you go back to the old days of allotments, the allotment holders, well, I'm taking London for example, the allotment holders there took care of the whole area. Council never came in there. They just took your money because of the water and everything else. That was it. But everybody was there to help each other. Oh, Joe can't make it. He's in hospital for 6 weeks. That's all right. That's fine. Paul, Sid, you do his allotment for a few weeks and we'll do the last few. It's about them all working together. Yeah. And it's setting up an allotment community, really.
Yeah. In an ideal world, this would be fantastic. But we live in reality. We don't live in an ideal world. We have conflicts amongst allotment holders.
That's
we have conflicts amongst associations on the site. There's a turnover of members on the association at all times, officers of elected things. We also have the problem of if we are directly funding some of these things for them to do things, which is nice, we would then have to assure that that money was spent in a very proper way, and they'd have to give us evidence of how it was spent. Also, they may have to get an extra insurance. Do we pay for their insurance or not? Because they're dealing with public money and everything. Something like, I don't know, Joe Bloggs might decide he wants to do a trip to Barbados and as a pathfinding trip. I know I'm being over the top there, but we don't know exactly how the money is going to be spent then. So there are a lot of complications to it. It's a brilliant idea to try to get cooperation amongst people, but I'd love to see how the and we have two very small allotments. How are we going to operate with them? I'm a naysayer, obviously.
I think we're just concentrating on Hyde at the moment. You know, it's a fact-finding tour. Very Road have given us the go-ahead to investigate more, and obviously it needs a lot of investigation. Financial side, as I say, the money that's spent for the allotments actually comes from the allotment holders. So we're sort of in a tournay. It is a fact-finding tour then, and I agree with what you're saying, Chris.
I must admit, Brenda used the right word. She said empowering. When I first became a councillor, someone said to me, we've always done it this way. That doesn't make it right. We've got to move forward. We're in 2021 now.
Yeah.
We're going forward. We are the experts on working on the allotments. The allotment holders are the experts. Mm-hmm. We can't trust the allotment holders to do and run their allotments properly. We've got a bit of an issue, haven't we? I mean, this is something we have to give it a go. We've got to move forward. We've moved forward in gigantic steps from 2015, when I first joined the allotment thing, to where we are now. This is logically the next step forward. It's not privatisation, it's a cooperative, isn't it?
I will propose that, Madam Chairman. I will propose that.
You know.
it's definitely not privatisation, it's like there's consent working together as a team, and we're trying to evolve. And like Chris has just said, we've come a long way since 2015 when we start. I mean, I haven't got anybody sitting at the back of me now shouting, start calling me names. I mean, it's such a big program, you know. So, but that's how it is. And now, I mean, we have the allotments. We move forward with the unofficial ones, which we'll come to in a bit. We move forward because we are learning from the allotment holders, and that's what we need. And it is trying to bring everybody together, and that's what we need to do as well. This is a pilot scheme. Once it's been thoroughly investigated, the committee have decided yes or no. That's not down for me, that's not down for Alan, that is down for the committee to decide whether or not. But it is a way forward.
I
need the second that.
Progress is what we need, but it's how the progress is done.
Just saying, as a committee, then we'll have ifs and ours and ours about, and I think quite right, it's a way forward, and it is giving our allotment holders representation by the
community. Democracy is the best
one.
It's imperfect, but it's the best.
Right, is that one? Is that a one? Item 298, engagement was taken.
I've put a table on it.
All right, I can now.
Right, it's type of engagement, physical site meetings by committee members.
We used to have, I have passed to cover the committee visits, site visit, site inspections, but as a committee we used to do twice a year, was it?
No, one time it was four times a year.
It was four times a year, yeah.
So tell us the two options. The first one, and I know the chair has indicated to me that you'd like site visits to happen, for the committee to go and do it. And I was just working out, we have six allotment sites, and we have a magnitude which is very small, so I think, you know, even if you did that once every 2 years, you'd probably meet everyone twice over. But it's really a matter of saying, do you want to visit them once a year or twice a year? And that's really what the question mark is there. You, Thetford Road being such a big site, you might want to do, you know, one extra visit and sacrifice one visit at Magdalen Street, for example. So that was really the proposal that we were asking for in that particular issue. The second one was just around, we have formal meetings with the associations. I know when I started getting involved, it was just as COVID struck, we used to have a Teams meeting beforehand, and a 1 hour team meeting, and there would be about three or four allotment representatives there. Dennis used to, Councillor Crawford used to chair that, there would be feedback. I only saw the ones, I can't say, you know, whether it was very well supported, but whether we had formal meetings, and again, it's just whether, if we do that, how often would you like to do that? You know, do you want to do it quarterly? Do you want to do it, you know, every second month? We have a lot of committee meetings every 2 months. Would you like to do one in between that? And then the last question, if you want to do that, is do you put all the allotment associations together, or do you have little roads and say, well, you know, Thetford Road, you come at this time, Berry Road, you come at this time, Ingle Way, you come at this time. It would just be a matter of doing that. And then the third option is just ad hoc workshops. And I think we do, for example, one of the projects that we've started that we haven't been able to finish because we've never had the workshop is the consolidated rules books. Mm-hmm. You know, because we wanted to consult with allotment holders. We didn't want to sit in our offices and chambers and make decisions that would impact on the allotment holders. We actually wanted to have that feedback. You know, and the one big issue of bonfires, for example, which we have, which has caused huge amounts of grief for allotment holders, for neighbours of allotments. You know, we would address that. And then the fourth one is just where you just have, you know, a longer public participation session before this meeting. So we come an hour before, and we allow a lot of associations to engage with the committee before then. So that's the options that we have, but I think it would be nice to, you know, the last meeting, we were just about to discuss this, but we had the pressure because we had another meeting straight afterwards. So we were really going through everything so fast, we didn't have a chance to really debate this. So I really developed those options. If there's any other options that the committee members have, you know, I'm sure you're going to. You'll set yourselves.
Okay, yeah, just, well, I'm in favour of having, us going on tours. I mean, physically I might not be able to do them as well as I used to do because some went through knee operations again. I think they were very useful in the past. We had the reps come along and show us around and everything, which is really helpful. We picked up quite a few infringements at those times, but I think we do have to moderate it in a way that if we're going to Ingle Way, that's quite a quick visit, isn't it? And we do it and that, but where Berry Road takes a couple of hours or something sometimes. So yeah, I'm in favour of us doing visits and things, and I also like the come back to having pre-meetings or meetings on the day, a couple of days before we have our committee meeting. Because if you have it a couple of days before, then when you go into the committee, you've had time to digest what has been said to you and what they want, and maybe even have a little bit of time to research what the... because it is important that the main problem we have with this committee in the past is we did not communicate well with our allotment holders. And I got a lot of stick for that too, so and I was partly responsible in a way. But I think we need to make sure that we continue our discussions with the allotment associations and the reps and to go forward. So however you want to do it, that's my opinion. A long-winded one.
I agree with the site inspections. I mean, I try to go around them all every month anyway. The informal meetings with the site reps, I would like to see in between our meetings. So we have our meetings every 2 months, so I'd like to see in between, as we had before, in the informal with the site reps, and he wants to come along, you know, in between the meetings, so we can have a discussion and see how we go from there. Mainly the site reps, we can invite. Would we like to invite just normal allotment holders?
We used to have it open for reps and allotment holders.
Yeah, I wouldn't be against that, depending, you know, but I mean, that would be my way. So I would bring it in between our meetings, so we're up to date, because we're 2 years behind, aren't we?
Oh, yeah.
You know, the ad hoc workshops, definitely. It depends what we do. I mean, we can do lots of stuff under ad hoc workshops, health and safety, et cetera, et cetera, bits and pieces. The longer public participation, I'll be allowed to extend that briefly. I thought 15 minutes was a legal thing.
Well, actually, it's just this committee that's not illegal. It's the thing that we give.
I know you'll be a full council, it's only 15 minutes.
So, well, standard orders permit the chair
up to.
No, 15 minutes, the chair can actually change that. So the chairman of every meeting is permitted to change that. This outstanding orders is 15 minutes, at least the chair decides otherwise.
Okay, so we have no objection to changing that around if we have lots of people asking. But if we have the informal meetings in between, you might not need this longer.
15 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, so basically.
Okay. Well, I agree with Chris, because if when we had the informal meetings and training sessions here, with Ros, we used to do training sessions as well. So we'd have their meetings, and you had time to digest anything that anybody said before the next meeting, you know, knowing how you're going to combat what the people have told you. Having them come in beforehand, a meeting, whether it's an hour before, you know, all the time you're trying to think off the cuff, and I don't like doing that, because when I go away from thinking off the cuff, I think I've done a mistake there. Well, it's too late because it's gone through a committee. So, yeah, I wouldn't like it on the same week. Plus, it takes a lot out of councillors, because, you know, meetings go on and on and on. So, and you've got other things that you've got to be doing, and so has the officers. That's what I'm saying, we've got cemeteries before, then you've got to get your mindset ready for allotment.
Yeah.
And it's a bit of a pain, is if in between you've then got the allotment holders in there, you know, when we're trying to agree stuff and the way forward, then that's not ready in paperwork to go for the committee anyway, so it's got to wait another month, so what's the point? Well, another 3 months, because if we'd met all allotment holders before this meeting, you can't then take it to a meeting because it's legal.
So
you know. So what is the point? If you meet a fortnight before,
and then we can put it on the agenda.
Then it can go as an agenda item. So Chris is right. It's
we do have another option. And whether people will support this or not, we understand the orders. We can co-opt non-councillors onto the committee, and they have a voting right then. If you look it up, there's a co-opt agenda where you can actually co-opt non-councillors.
I don't think they have a voting right. You can co-opt them on.
I think they do have a voting right, Brenda. If you look.
No, they can speak of their knowledge, can't they? They don't have a right because you're not an elected member.
Don't you think you could have a working group where an unelected member has a vote, but you couldn't, a committee councillor, my understanding. They have changed standing orders quite a bit in the last few years.
I'm fairly
certain that, but I stand to be corrected.
But even if you had a co-opted member on the committee, at least they would be able to have a voice during the meeting.
Spokesperson. Now he didn't have a voting right, but he would pull that whole council apart, you know, better than what the councillors was.
I'm sure our chair will look up and see if I have spoken wrongly. I've always thought a cooperative on this committee specifically to be able to co-opt members onto it. Even if they were non-voting, at least then they would have a right to have a say.
I think that's something we need to look at, because if that's a case on this one, then that should be a case on all committees.
It's all, it covers all committees. Except for, I don't think it does plan.
About finance, we're going to do it either way.
Well, finance, you can co-opt experts in.
So are we agreeing with what Chris said, at least a fortnight, if not more, before our committee meetings?
Well, that's what
I meet with the reps and the allotment holders, because we've got to think, you know, reps to me are the people that actually manage and try and get people to work with them, but then you might have some that don't want to work with them and they want to bring their things forward. So,
right, so you know. Should we take this in part then? Right, the actual committee visits, site visits for the committee to do site visits.
Not monthly.
No, I thought we've done it twice a year.
We used to do it twice, and then we used to do it four, and then we reduced to three and two. But during the winter time, there's not a lot goes on in allotments.
That's why we reduced.
And so we could cut out certain periods of the year and only have the visits during the active part of the season. I know winter people can clear their allotments and do things like that, but it would be more sensible to when the growing period is and people are busy on their allotments, than having it all year round and us tramping around in -7 degrees temperatures.
So basically, when we did that, we reduced it to two, and we had them at certain times of the month of the year.
We usually have an officer with us.
Carl
start waning off a little bit.
You do want
to send me away.
No, I'll tell you, the reason I was saying that, either you or was it, is just to make sure that the councillors, what I'm saying is it doesn't need, I mean, I would only do Mountford Road personally, because I'm not going to start walking all the way over the other side of town. So it's where you're situated is where you should be inspecting. So if I said I would do Mountford Road and the one down there, Berry Road, that's takes you into town. What's that one called?
Maggage.
No, the one that takes you into town. Well, actually, yeah. No, that's even further away. The one where Dennis used to live.
Berry Road.
In the flats.
Berry Road.
Berry Road, right? So if I said I'd do them two, because that's in walking distance of me, you start to share them out. And then and you say to the officers, well, what day should we go? This is the day that we're going to do the, you know,
but I'm just saying, taking Coral's statement in, do we have to do them all on one day?
No, that's not that.
Because that's what used to kill us off, and I'm one of the guilty ones. I used to do like two or three allotments and then say, I'm going home because it just can't happen anymore.
Right, so if we do two slight visits a year, the first one in May. No, the first one's the beginning.
Inspections carried out inspections you're talking about, is it more of an informal inspection, or are you expecting letters to be sent out after your inspection?
As we used to do, where the letters usually go out after an inspection.
Yeah.
Proper committee inspections, yeah.
So yeah, I do like a roll-in inspection where I go out throughout the year, all the way through the year doing these inspections. So I sort of, you might be picking on plots which have already got notices and letters they're receiving anyway. I wonder if it'd be better if you do like an informal one, and you're engaging with the allotment community as well, if people are up there.
Yeah, we done that, you can always turn around and say to us, well, this one's happening.
I mean, if there's any particular thing
you want to
add on, I can,
that does make sense. Yeah, that makes sense.
So we're going informal now then. An informal meeting where we would say...
We do informal allotment things, but if we obviously see, if because can't do this and doing the letters, getting the letters sent out, etc., etc., if we turn around and go up and then we say, oh, what about this one? Carl can turn around and say, well, the letter's done on that. Then we're not done badly enough, of course, in wasting time. If the letter ain't gone out, we say, well, and then Carl says, no, I'll get the letter out for that one. So it's sort of informal, formal, if you like.
So is it informal? We walk around the allotments, write down anything we pick up, send that in to Carl, and then Carl will have the answers.
Well, hopefully Carl will be with us so he can turn around and
say... Well, I think what he's saying is...
I don't mind coming around with you.
As long as the interest is kept there and it's kept to what we're supposed to do instead of our minds moving off to it.
Was the way it used to go was that you'll get the allotment administrator coming with us, and she'll be jotting things down, and also then a hand will go up on the plot over there. And this is where she'll be trying to figure out what plot it was and write notes.
Yeah, that was the problem.
And I don't think half the letters went out because she had so much information all at once.
So right, so we do first one now, dates permitted from the officers, because we've got to work around the officers, so we do a visit May, visit September, in September, informal formal, where we go, Carl can turn around and either say, even if he puts it down, gives it to Alan, whatever, this is the lot, these are bad letters, these haven't. If we say anything, we can add it to the list, then Carl can sort that out. Let's say, dates permitting when the officers are available, so if we do two for May and September, that would be our two unofficial site visits. Then we've got to get up and running our unofficial allotment meetings again, like we used to have before the COVID, whereas we invite the reps and allotment holders if they so wish. It's an unofficial meeting. We air the grounds. If there's any complaints like we did before, nothing different as such. There's no chair of that committee because it's an informal one. We get all the all the ideas and feedback from the allotments like we did before. As I say, no change. And we get them start running up. And as you say, we've got our feedback coming. If we have our meetings it's four a year, isn't it? We have meetings. So if we have four meetings.
Well, six a year now.
It's gone up.
We don't have committee meetings
in August or December. So how are we getting six?
We voted six a year is what we did vote in.
For last year.
Yeah.
These are formal committee meetings.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
So if we're getting six meetings a year, I mean that doesn't include August and December because committees don't meet in August and September, December.
Yeah. We did have a voting plan in August.
I had to rearrange it.
Yeah. So this is the August meeting happening in September. We will have another meeting in October. And we will have a budget meeting in November because we have to approve the budget.
So we've got 3 months. Right, unofficial meetings then. Best off having them like we used to, as I said before, so that we can get the paper, make our comments and notes. We can take the comments and that from the allotment holders and
So we're having six in here.
We could still have four, and I think that would work, because at the budget meeting, for example, your focus is really
approving
the budget. You know, you don't really want to
have
too many other things on the agenda, because the budget would be the tough one.
Yeah. So getting these informal meetings again set up, if we do that the month before the official meeting, that way the paperwork, and that should be done. Is that okay?
It'll help you set your agenda, won't it?
So is that an agreement with the committee or?
We've got to look at Tom, because you're saying they're informal and they can come. Ros used to give up, I think, her own time on Sunday.
We used to have them about 5 o'clock.
But I think some of that was Ros's time. She wouldn't commit to that.
Yeah, I mean.
So we have to be careful.
But it's got to be done in a way that people that work and just go to the allotments in the evening, go to the allotments at weekends and evenings. So they'd be at work for the day, so they can't come during the day. So do we have two of them, one during the day for allotment holders and men, and one later on in the evening? That is an officer time that we will have to work through.
I think you just have to stick to an evening one. You can't add two a month.
I think an evening one would be fine. Would it be at the Carnegie? Would that be?
We had it in here, and then we've had it at the Guildhall.
Whichever venue is available.
Yeah.
We're flexible. On our inspections, they don't have to be all negative. We can pick up positives on our inspections.
No, positive as well.
I'm just wanting to get that across.
We don't go around just to be cold.
You've got 16 chickens, you're only allowed 10, but you know what, they're really nice.
That's a kind of thing. Right, so are we finished on that one?
We need a vote, don't we?
Can I just clarify, so it's to be two informal meetings in May and September in the evening.
So the site visits.
Two site visits May and September.
Yeah.
And then informal meetings four informal meetings per year.
Yes, thank you.
But do we need to vote on that?
We do.
Okay, can I have a proposal, that, please?
I'll propose it.
Yes.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris.
Are you all in favour of any abstentions?
We had some feedback, you know, that people were looking forward to it. Some people had input into it. And what I was just wondering is, could we get someone just to, you know, on a small short-term contract to actually finish it off? Maybe one of those informal ad hoc workshops. We could just table it and get some feedback and get a working group going and then get it complete.
That's what we used to do with the allotment people.
Each time a
rule was changed or something, when we talked to them, we'd all agree around that table, and then would go back.
Glenn was so great for Pete from Bowman Road.
But this is not the rule book, just to make it clear. This is just the actual handbook. I think Carl gave me a lot of feedback. It's quite popular. He thought it was very good.
So we just need it collaborated.
So can I get a quote for an editor and bring it back to the committee?
Yeah.
You want editors?
Or a draft?
Someone to oversee it?
No, I want someone to actually finish it off.
Oh, right. Oh, yeah.
Because unfortunately, at officer level, you know, unless we're talking 2025.
Do we have to go back to finance for funding for that?
No, I think we.
You've got enough, haven't we?
We provided money in our budget for publications.
Okay, great.
So that will be the update of the development handbook guide. Can I? There is one thing I noticed taking place. When I saw the allotment and gardens and allotments book for the judging side of things, I noticed on the cover. And I can't find it on my emails now. But I noticed there's some really good set out rules on there for how they judge the allotments, what you judge them for. That's why I'm looking over this side. That is something I think would be how that's set out and it's worded on the tidiness, how you know what they expect from allotments that would be good as inside our first lot rules, because it's actually setting out what is expected of allotment holders. And if you haven't seen that, I'll ask Brian, could you just forward that piece over to the committee, to me, and I can forward it out or to Alan?
Yeah.
Because it's something that it just caught my eye, because it was so there, it's good. Have you seen it?
Yeah, well, I've seen it on the gate. Is it the same?
It's what they expect, and the idea to have in front of their rule books. That's okay, so we'll sort that out. But yeah.
So that's what you want in front of the book, what Alan's going to get somebody to
do. I would put it inside.
So you need the ASAP then. You'll need the ASAP then, won't you?
Yeah, I mean, I've got it somewhere on my emails, but.
Yeah, you're just going to sign that.
Do we have to pay for copyright?
No, I'll speak to the man who wrote it instead, so you're all right.
Oh, right, okay.
But yeah, I mean, it's really good.
Sounds good, yeah.
Yeah. So that's step two, reviewing the basis of chain charging tenants between the 1st of July and 10th of October each year. In principle, approval to charge allotment fees for the period 1st of July to 9th of October of the following year. Allotment fees are non-refundable.
Just to provide some clarity, what happens is from the 30th of June till the 10th of October, anyone who takes out an allotment in that period does not pay an allotment fee. So if they take out the allotment, they don't pay a fee, and what we were finding is that people were relinquishing their allotments on the 10th of or the 9th of October, and then they'd actually had the use of the allotment site for free of charge.
For the summer months.
For the summer months. Ooh. So what we were looking at and what we were proposing is to actually say, well, if someone takes an allotment from the 1st of July, they would still pay the annual allotment fee, but that would last until the 10th of October of the following year. So they couldn't relinquish it. If they relinquished it, they would still use a fee if they relinquished it, just to use it for the summer and not get any payment for it. So it's just something that's in our fee structure, and it was just a matter of whether we could actually put a formal proposal to this committee to approve at the next meeting to incorporate that. Because like I said, we were finding situations where people were just using a lot of free of charge for 3 months and then disappearing.
No, they need to pay the full fees.
Do we have a lot of that? Is there a lot of that?
It's probably not as much now, but people are aware of it. So we can't stop it if they do it.
What does the committee think?
I think we should charge them.
Can I put it?
I don't think allotments are that expensive when you look at what other people's things are. We're quite cheap for the size of our flocks. So,
Barbara, what do you think? I do. I mean, we have sort of a similar structure in the museum where you pay halfway through the year, that covers you for that bit of the year and the following year as well. So it's consistent throughout. If they don't pay anything, they could take advantage of the situation. You know, think, actually, it's not for me, I'll just
get another one next year.
decision. It was really just kind of put a proposal to the next allotment committee meeting on this matter.
Are you all in agreement?
Yes.
Nothing that we're not going to deal with in the under the individual tenants issues. I have had quite a lot of advance looking at me. I have had some correspondence from her. And we will discuss it in the non-public part of the meeting.
Committee officers up though. Top date, any official information since the agenda was released?
Just to say that the Reds notifications will go out next week. We're supposed to issue them a month in advance, and the last few years we haven't achieved that. This year I've determined we will, so they will go out next week.
Thank you.
Can I ask the question, please?
Yeah.
You were talking earlier about budget setting in November. We discussed this at cemetery. I think you're leaving budget setting very late in the year for that to get to finance, then finance to then prepare it for town council. So you're doing what you've done last year and then told everybody off to set your budgets early. Is there any way that you can, Dave's going to talk to you about, a pre-only budget meeting so that that is ready rather than leaving it till November? We're leaving everything. November's very late to start preparing.
The idea is that the committee's actually considered their first draft of the budget in October. And if they want any changes, so it could go to October finance.
Yeah.
And then if they want any changes, it would then go to November.
But you can't do that if we're not starting until November.
No, we start off.
My understanding on the budget finance table, the budget timetable, and that has October as the first draft, November as the second draft, all the final budget proposals. Right. I'll double check that for you.
But I think we'll be on track if it is October, November. Yeah.
2 months. Yeah. Previously, what happens to we didn't have meetings in November, so if you didn't have your meetings, if you didn't approve your budget in October, we had to call special meetings.
Yeah.
Do you remember last year we had about 9 or 10
special
meetings?
Yes. Yeah.
To bring the budget.
Right. Is there anything else
on
that one? Three O two, community engagement. Would be prejudicial to public by reason of the confidential nature of business to be discussed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for attending our
conference.
Thank you.